Okay, and we'll continue singing our second song. The only thing, yours will be, maybe a little volume on that one. Not there, Tom.
Flying out there today.
I read a daily devotional called Our Daily importance of following moral principles in the practice of medicine, and he's credited with writing the Hippocratic Oath, which still serves as an ethical guide for today's medical doctors. One key concept of the oath is to do no harm. It implies that a physician will do only what he thinks will benefit his patient. The principle of doing no harm extends to our relationships with others in everyday life. In fact, benevolence is central to New Testament teaching about loving others. In reflecting on the law of God, Paul sees that love is the intent behind many biblical commands. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law, in Romans 13:10. Each day as we follow Jesus Christ, our Savior, we're faced with choices that will affect the lives of others. When we choose a course of action, we should ask ourselves, does this reflect Christ's concern for others, or my only concern for myself? Such a sensitivity demonstrates the love of Christ who seeks to heal the broken and help those in need. In the bottom little devotional sentences, caring for the burdens of others helps us to forget about our own. Isn't that the truth? So if you'll join me in a quick prayer. Lord, I admit that it's easy to be consumed with my own wants and needs. Thank you that you showed us how to be concerned for others too. Help me to follow your example in caring for others.
Thank you.
I'll start with Linda Haley is requesting some summer help with the following. Someone to take donations to me once a week or even just once. And someone to take aluminum cans to be recycled. See Linda sign up for that or just do it. She is grateful for your help.
And somebody did just do it last week, so
awesome. So yeah, see Linda. Okay. And today, this morning, we served 76.
That was Thursday.
Oh, okay. Thursday night at Camille, there were 76 who were fed. And it was Catherine, Wendy, Kelly, Brad, and Laura. And then for breakfast this morning, we had 50 meals. And there was Dave, Barry, Wanda, Catherine, and Dan and Lance. Thank you all for committing that Saturday. Thanks for helping our homeless in Charlotte. Also, this little red folder at the end of your few rows there, we'd ask that you would please open up that and allow a piece of paper in there. You can put the date on there and just list your name on that attendance page. That way we'll know that you were here with us and that, that helps Wendy keep track of our attendance records there. Rocky's Faith Day tickets need to be paid for by the 15th of July. You can see Wanda Denny for that. There's Wanda. Grocery cards will be available on Sunday mornings sporadically during the summer in the narthex due to vacations and that kind of thing. So if you miss it one Sunday, come back the next Sunday and they'll be there, maybe. Okay. Maybe. Martha Circle, it was posted on the screen in the announcements there before worship that on the 19th they would be meeting, but that has been canceled. They will not be meeting on the 19th, so it'll be August 16th. Okay, it's also on the screen. But we'll meet from 9 to 1 on the 16th, Martha Circle. Bradley Kushel has learned some practice secrets that his piano teacher taught him, and he'd like to pass those on to anyone, young or old, who is experienced or may not have a whole lot of experience with practice, that may be studying piano or just need some help getting to that next level. So if you would like some help with practicing, he would like to share those tips with you, Brad. So talk with Brad and see how he might be able to help you do that. There's no monetary cost, only the promise that you will commit your time to practicing. Excellent. Thank you, Brad. During the month of July, Cheyenne and I met as pastors. We'll be swapping pulpits to share different first-person perspectives of biblical characters. And in addition to that, they will lead a Wednesday night study on that same character from 6 to 8. Watch the bulletin and Grace Notes for schedules and more information as those come up. Also, help us gear up for Vacation Bible School. You've noticed in our hallway on the wall there are displays for Vacation Bible School in the narthex. There are a display of items that are needed for Vacation Bible School. So if you'd like to donate some of those items, just take the top tag off and put your name on the matching tag that's stuck underneath there. Return the top tag with your items to the church office by Sunday, July 13th. There's also a little folder there for that has registration forms. So take one or more of those to invite your friends, family, and neighbors. And activities are for all ages. VBS will run Monday, July 28th through Thursday, the 31st. Dinner will begin at 5:30 and the program is 6 to 8:30. The Palettes are starting their large construction project. They have started it. It's in process. And on the 7th, construction. The demolition has been done, but now the construction begins on the 7th. So for all who have said, if there's anything you need, let us know. Now is the time. If you have construction skills, or would like to help, or would like to learn some construction skills, they're good at teaching that too. But then whatever level of skill or unskill you have in the area, you're needed. And they would teaching and learning, right? So gophers are also needed. Gopher this, gopher that kind of gopher. So see Pam if you can work an hour or a day or more. And thanks. Prayer and care team will meet in the upper room today at the church. But please go get food at the potluck in Grace Hall first and bring it back to the meeting. And speaking of potluck, it is this Sunday, so we have a potluck over in Grace Hall. If you forgot, I did, and didn't bring anything for the potluck, Albertson is just down the street at the Safeway. But then always remember that there's always planning, and just come and join in the fellowship that we have in that time together after worship. Okay, I think that's all the announcements. Wow. All right, so celebration time. Do we have some birthdays and anniversaries? On June 30th, Jay Webb has a birthday. And on the 4th of July, the firecracker, Justin Earnshaw. Happy birthday to those. And our anniversaries on July 3rd, Ken and Lindy Keel, 10 years, they're celebrating marriage. And Bill and Gail Graves on that same date. Right, Mindy is their daughter. So they're celebrating 54 years. So congratulations to those, and we enjoy being able to celebrate with them on these occasions in their lives. Any other announcements? Okay, and at this time, oh, and what is her name? Taylor will be 1 year old, celebrating her first anniversary of the year on the 5th of July. Well, happy birthday to you, Taylor. Thank you for being here with us in worship today. Thank you. And we'll make sure and get that on our records in the office. Anything else? Okay. It is my honor and my pleasure to invite you to quiet your hearts. Prepare your minds and your spirits as we continue in worship. day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Please remain standing. We will be doing, throughout the summer, we'll be doing a stanza or so of some of your favorites. It's kind of a medley of hymns. But before we do that, we've added in the past one of the peace. You can reach out and take your neighbor's hand and share the peace of Christ with them. Oh, yes. The peace of Christ.
And this is what I think kids are wise.
Not everyone who says to me, look, wrong one, everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. But then Jesus says, but if everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. So what do you think? If you were going to build a house, should you build it on rock or sand? Yeah, because what would happen if you built it on sand? He did this. It's perfect. Can you hold this? Because guess what? There's a song about it! So here we go. Join in if you know it. The wise man built his house upon a rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rain came down.
letter. We're switching microphones and hoping that we don't get all that static. Our scripture lessons for this morning, we have two. The first one comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. You have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift." And the second scripture is from Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 17. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault, between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. The word of God is the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We pray with me. Heavenly Father, I ask that you be a conduit of your words, that you help me to say the words that you would have me to say, and have all of us listen to those words and be the conduit of change as we go forward today. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So I want to start today with a show of hands. How many of you, as you sit here today, have ever had a broken relationship, have ever needed to heal a broken relationship, or has ever been the cause of a broken relationship? Come on now. I understand people not raising your hands. Let's be honest. Come on now. I tried to make it all inclusive so everyone can hear. Are you done all three? If we haven't, we probably haven't lived life. Have we? We haven't been part of the human condition. Yeah, some of us are raising two hands, saying, "Hallelujah, who I am," right? So today we're going to talk about healing broken relationships and what we need to do, why it's important that we do it, how we can be better at it, no matter how long it's been, and why it's never too late to reach out and heal those relationships. I'm going to shape the conversation today around one particular, almost 150-year-old broken relationship that's deeply, deeply rooted in our Methodist history. And I talked to a couple of you this morning already who said, "I can't wait to hear what you have to say because I know the story and I don't think most of the people in the audience do." I've talked to others who said, "I'm really interested in hearing what's going on because I've seen a little bit of information, but I don't know much about it." And I'll be honest, right off the bat, I had no idea that there was a Methodist connection to the Sand Creek Massacre. And so when we get to that point, it was eye-opening for me, let's put it that way, and hopefully it will be for you as well. But that broken relationship took a giant step toward healing within the last couple of weeks, and so we'll be talking about that also. First of all, though, it's obvious from the scripture readings today that Jesus had something to say about the importance of healing relationships, right? He gave us some direct instructions in Matthew about what we needed to do. Matthew 5, which is part of the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus teaches disciples what it means to live as his people, tells us that we have to go beyond just following the law. That following the law is not important, or not enough. It's important, but it's not the be-all, end-all of being a disciple. We have to allow God's word to penetrate our hearts, and we have to then act on it in that regard. In terms of relationships, that means we get rid of our sin of anger and insult towards others, or at least find a healthier way of dealing with them, right? It's not appropriate to sit back and think, "Well, at least I didn't hurt them physically." You know, we'll talk about Sand Creek, and people were killed in a horrendous way, and then things went beyond that. But so it's one thing to compare it to other sins and say, "Well, yeah, I'm angry with them, and I'm holding on to my anger and my resentment, but at least I didn't hurt them physically." Come on, really? That's not what Jesus wants us to do. Instead, he's asking us to work toward a word that many of us have heard many times before, and that's reconciliation. And so we're going to talk about what it means to reconcile and think about what that true reconciliation looks like. Does it mean just saying, "I'm sorry," and moving on, walking past? I think about when my kids were little and how we said, "Say sorry, sorry. Say sorry nicely,
that's not saying sorry. You can tell when a child really means it, right? Or whether they're doing it to placate mom and dad. And so the sorry nicely is the joke in our family, right? Say sorry and sorry nicely. So reconciliation must always be the goal, but who should take the first step? Who do you think? The offender or the offended? Who takes the first step?
The one closest to God.
The one closest to God, exactly. It doesn't matter, it should always be us, right? So we're going to talk about that as well. It doesn't matter whether we're the offender or we're the one who's offended. God puts it on us to be the one to initiate the reconciliation. When we're the one who's at fault, often our shame gets the best of us, and we can't admit that we're the one who hurt somebody. Maybe we assume the other person won't want to hear from us, or that the damage is too great to repair. Jesus' instruction cuts through all that. He says, don't busy yourself with important religious activities. Let yourself be distracted. And definitely don't make excuses for what happened. Instead, seek out the person you hurt, make the first move, and do all you can to reconcile and heal the relationship. But what if you're on the other end? What if you're the one who's been hurt? Matthew 18, the second scripture, tells us what should happen when we've been wronged. And guess what? We still get to be the one who seeks reconciliation. Why is it important that we initiate that? They're the one who hurt us, right? Shouldn't we wait for them to come to us and apologize? I mean, for crying out loud, I'm the one hurting. Why do I have to take the first step? I want you to listen to this section of an online devotional that I found, and these words are much better than anything I can come up with. It says, let's be honest. When someone sins against us, we find countless ways to compound their error with sin of our own. We start to assume the worst and to read evil into all their actions. We sulk quietly, nurturing bitterness and resentment, perhaps even beginning to lash out at others. We play the martyr and forget that we're imperfect sinners who hurt people too. We share our hurt and pain with friends, in other words, we gossip. We claim the moral high ground and say, they did the wrong thing, let them make the first move to sort it out. Wonderfully, mercifully, Jesus gives us the alternative. We begin by approaching the person who's wronged us individually. If they see their fault, that's the end of the matter. Their repentance and your forgiveness bring about reconciliation. If, however, they don't see their fault, approach them again, this time with one or two other people. Now's where it gets uncomfortable, right? You're showing up with some friends. What are those people doing here? Now we're going to have a different kind of conversation, right? And then that doesn't work either. Have anybody been in this situation? You confronted somebody by yourself, now you brought some friends, guess what? Jesus takes it a step further. He says, tell the church. What does that mean? Tell the church. Can you imagine me standing up here and saying, Melanie hurt me, and Melanie just won't listen. She won't reconcile with me. And I brought Michelle, and I brought Leo, and we talked to her, and she still doesn't get it. So guess what, folks? It's Sunday morning. We're standing up here. We're going to talk about it. Tell the church. Now it gets really awkward, right? Really uncomfortable. She's running out the back door, or she's like, please. She might reconcile very quickly, but it's out of embarrassment, right? But now the whole church is involved. At each step along the way, the goal is not to embarrass, take revenge or air dirty laundry. The goal is genuine reconciliation between the offender and the offended. So how does it bring it to the whole church out? Well, that's kind of the last resort, right? We hope it doesn't get to that point. The bottom line is this. Jesus tells us that we have to step up and be the first one to go toward reconciliation. Which brings us to this year's annual conference session, which wrapped up last Sunday in Pueblo, Colorado. We had 3.5 days of group discussions, legislative actions, memorial services, clergy appointments. We're happy to know that Reverend Sandy has been reappointed as our pastor for another year. So we get to celebrate with her. So it was a lot of the same old business that we do at annual conference every year, except this time it was in a different location and for a very distinct reason. Bishop Elaine took us to Pueblo on a year when we were supposed to be in Denver. In our conference, every 3 years we're at the Denver Tech Center in the Marriott, and then the fourth year we traveled to somewhere in the conference. This was not going to be a travel year, this was going to be in Denver year. But 2 years ago at General Conference in 2012, there was an act of reconciliation. Motion was passed and discussed about Sand Creek, and she made a commitment at that point that we would take a pilgrimage to the Sand Creek Massacre site, and Pueblo is the nearest big city to have our commission and do that. So the most important thing I think that we did during that time is we did a little bit of business on Thursday. All of day Friday was in pilgrimage to Sand Creek, and then we were back to work Saturday and had our ordination and appointment service on Sunday morning. So we'll go to the next slide. How many of you have seen these signs around our area? How many, keep your hands up, how many of you know what they mean? Most of you, get your hand up, good for you. I have to admit that I have seen these signs for years and didn't take the time to know what they meant. I talked to somebody else this morning who said she was as equally convicted as I was, that she'd see the sign and then say, I'll go look that up, you know, I'll find out what that means. And I have no excuse, the internet rides around in my pocket all the time, I could have grabbed it and looked at any point. But I didn't, and I didn't have an idea at all what the Sand Creek Massacre Trail was all about, why these signs existed, why are they in Wyoming? And then when I discovered that the Sand Creek Massacre took place on the eastern plains of Colorado, it still didn't make any sense. So I'm glad to know now when I see the signs what they mean, so we'll talk about that. This one's on Paris Highway 85, by the way, so on the edge of Washington. This is Colonel John Shivington, former Methodist preacher and the leader of the 1st Colorado Cavalry. He's the guilty party in this story. He and the territorial governor at the time, John Evans, both Methodists, both developed an extreme hatred for the Native American people. Obviously, a lot of skirmishes going on at the time, but they had gradually developed some kind of peaceful relations. Shivington was having none of it. This is a guy who, again, Methodist preacher, trained in John Wesley's rules, do no harm, do good, stay in love with God, obviously set that all aside. And many of the stories say he became power hungry. He became a leader of the military and he said, I've got this army at my command, I get to do whatever I want. And so on November 29th, 1864, so this fall, 150 years ago, he acted on his own. It wasn't under the governor's direction. But he led 675 soldiers to attack the peaceful encampment of Cheyenne and Arapaho people at Sand Creek. A legacy was started that hasn't healed in 150 years, and most of us as Methodists probably don't know that we're connected to it. Next slide, please. Here's a very different United Methodist leader. On the screen, you can see her a little bit. That's Bishop Elaine Smowski. She's our current bishop of the Mountain Sky area, as it's called now. We're part of the Rocky Mountain Annual Conference, but so is the Yellowstone Annual Conference also combined, and the Bishop Elaine is Bishop of both conferences. It was called the Denver area, which didn't mean a whole lot, and so this past year they changed the name of the Mountain Sky. This was during her Episcopal address on Thursday morning. This was the start of annual conference at the Pueblo Convention Center, and she shared the story of the massacre with us as survivors of the massacre sat in the audience. And some Native American leaders spoke to us as well. But she shared the story about why 600 United Methodists that week were about to make a pilgrimage out to the site on Friday, and why it was important for us to do that. Next slide, please. Here's Bishop Elaine greeting some people as they board the bus. This was the bus that left right before us. It's between 6:30 and 7 in the morning, and as Bishop Elaine reminded us on Thursday, John Wesley rose early as well. So I think you get up and ride horseback to share the message, or you get up early and make a pilgrimage to Sand Creek. When we boarded the bus, we all got little booklets that kind of included some historical information. I want to read a little bit about why we took the pilgrimage, because I think that's important to know the distinction. It says, we're going to the site of the Sand Creek Massacre because God is at work there and has invited us to be part of the work. 150 years ago, Cheyenne and Arapaho people died in a bloody massacre at the hands of cavalry troops led by a Methodist minister. Native people know this history, Methodist people do not. We are taking this pilgrimage because descendants of the survivors of the massacre have invited us to learn our shared history, to understand the church's role in westward expansion that benefited settlers at the expense of indigenous peoples, and to join them in healing the generational and cultural wounds caused by the massacre. Next slide. There's a couple of our bus buddies. Sandy and Luann, who neither one could be here today, but if we're going to complain at all about anything, it was that we were freezing to death on the back of the bus. That's what we get for sitting on the back of the bus. When we got to the site, though, we were appreciative of the air conditioning. It was 99 degrees at the site, and it was going to be 104 later that afternoon. So we were glad we got there at 10 in the morning. rather than for the activity.
Next slide. This is a map that shows the area. I wanted to mainly give you an idea if you don't know where the Sand Creek Massacre site is. You can look in the upper left side and see the Wind River Indian Reservation and follow that down to Fort Laramie and to the corner there where we live and down to Denver. The two shaded areas, the first one is the 1851 treaty territory, and then you can see that 10 years later another treaty was signed. Look how much the land shrunk. So this is the history of the settlers and the native people, of course. We know this history, a lot of the study at the school, but as the time progressed and we kept renegotiating, and our renegotiations worked in our favor and didn't work in the native people's favor. So their land continued to shrink, and the area that we asked them to stay on and live on shrunk as well. Sand Creek Massacre site here is almost as far as you can get east in Colorado, where you're in Kansas. But it was a 2.5 hour bus ride from Pueblo to this site, and so it was a little bit of a long trip. Next slide. Our pastor fell asleep on the way. Many people enjoyed the trip. We listened to native folks telling us about what the pilgrimage meant to them, what Sand Creek means to them, and why it was important that we make the pilgrimage. So, next slide. After, again, most of the 2 hours, we arrived at the Sand Creek Massacre National Historic Site. The interesting part of the history of the site is it's only been a National Park Historic Site since 2007, and that's incredibly recent for an event that happened almost 150 years ago. It was 142 years after the massacre before we finally acknowledged it and made it a historic site. The Senator Ben Nighthorse Campbell passed a bill in 1998 in Congress that started the process of researching. They didn't even really know where the actual massacre had taken place. They had an idea, but they did an extensive research project, excavated some remains of the site, discovered exactly where it was, and then had to buy the ranch from private individuals and make it a National Park Service site. It's about 1,150 acres the National Park Service has, and when you get to this site, you've got about 8 miles of gravel road before you drive onto the site. Next slide. There are interpretive signs along the way that tell the story of the massacre, and then there's a trail where you'll see in a minute where you can walk along and look over a ridge into the valley where the people were encamped. Next slide. This is, again, there were 600 of us. We went in three different time shifts, and so there were buses coming and going pretty much all day long. The first two shifts arrived at 10 in the morning and walked along, and we had about an hour and a half at the site where we were able to walk along and look at the site. We had prayer cards that were given that we could read the prayer, stop and consider what had happened, share the prayer card, or exchange prayer cards with other Methodists that were on the pilgrimage. But the idea, the reminder was, it's a pilgrimage, not a tourist trip. So we were invited not to take pictures of Native people or certain parts of the site without their permission. So you won't find any photos that I share with you today of Native Americans, except at the very end, from the back at the dinner. But we were asked to be incredibly respectful of the site and respectful of the people telling the story. The real true blessing was getting to hear their stories and hear from them why this was still such a deep wound 150 years later. We'll talk about that again in a minute. There's a little circle of stones, and there's a marker right near the awning that you saw where you can sit and have a little bit of shade. You can go to the next slide. If you can't read it, it says Sand Creek Battlegrounds, November 29th to 30th, 1864. One thing this was not, it was a battle. It was a massacre. It was a battle to a limited extent, and that the Native Americans did try to fight back a little bit, but it was truly a slaughter. It was the cavalry troops went in. Most of the encampment was women and children, some peaceful chiefs, as you'll hear about again when I read a little bit of the history, but they were not prepared for what was coming and had no idea. They thought they were in a peaceful place where the governor actually told them to go and camp at that site and that they would be left alone if they stayed there, and then all of a sudden they weren't left alone. So that really needs to be taken away. It's not really out there. This is probably what the site, somewhat what the site looked like. It's not a historical shot of the site. site looks like. You're looking north is on the right side, you see the white line. So there's a ridge with bluffs, and we walked all along the edge of the bluffs, looking down into the valley, the area where the creek, Big Sandy Creek runs. As you can see where the cavalry approached from below, and then attacked, and the Cheyenne Arapaho people escaped from the top. The Sand Creek Massacre Trail is the trail that those who managed to escape when the massacre site took to get up through our area and up to the Wind River Reservation, among other places. So that's why the trail signs are where they are, because that follows the route for those who managed to escape. So the sign says, help respect sacred ground, and it really is sacred ground for the people. I want to read about what happened from the brochure that was put out by the Park Service. And you're invited to close your eyes if you want to try a picture looking at this image, what happened naturally. It says, the sun rising at their backs, a long column of riders moved out to drive Big Sandy Creek towards teepees along its banks. The village of 700 Cheyenne and Arapaho people were stirred, attending the chores. The temporary camp was along the northern border of the Fort Wise treaty lands, where most felt protected. Hearing distant hoofbeats, Indian women called out, the buffalo are coming. But on this cold November morning, the buffalo were hundreds of blue-clad soldiers. The alarm went through the village. Peace Chief Black Kettle raised a U.S. flag and a white flag of truce, signals of peaceful intentions. Men gathered weapons and young herders moved to pony herds. Women, children, and elderly began their evacuation up the Dry Creek Channel and onto the plains. Cheyenne Chief's Black Kettle, standing in the water and white antelope, with the Arapaho chief left hand, walked toward the mounted soldiers to ask for a parley. Cavalrymen crossed the creek, firing into them in the village. All the Black Kettle were killed or mortally wounded. Colonel John Shivington arrived with the artillery at the edge of the village. He gave the order to fire, then ordered the howitzers upstream. As soldiers scattered over many square miles, command and control was soon lost, and soldiers died in their own crossfire. The Colorado 3rd Regiment, a group of 100 named U.S. volunteers, lost all unit integrity. Soon, individuals in small squads chased after Indians in all directions. Captain Soles and Lieutenant Kramer's units of the 1st Regiment refused to fire, standing down and remaining in formation. And if there's one hero in the story, it's Captain Silas Soles. And in the booklet, there's Captain Soles' letter that he wrote to Congress to testify to what he saw happen that day. And there's probably no more horrific thing that I've read in any of my study of history than what we've done for Native people, because he talks in great detail about what he's done with folks during and after the massacre. But he stood and refused to fight. Of the 100 fighting age men in the camp, some formed lines of battle trying to cover those fleeing. Into the early afternoon, soldiers poured a relentless fire at the stragglers until their ammunition ran out. Most who surrendered were executed. The treeless stream bed provided little cover. Groups of villagers dug pits in the bed of it in a desperate attempt to escape bullets. These sand pits proved worthless against almost point-blank howitzer fire. Most of the women, children, and elderly who were killed lost their lives in the sand pits. Soldiers pursued Indians fleeing over the prairie, riding down and killing those they found. When the firing ended, 165 to 200 Cheyenne and Arapaho people were killed. Two-thirds of them, women, children, and elderly. Another 200 were wounded or maimed. Of the Army's 675 soldiers, about 16 were killed and 70 wounded. The next day, some soldiers looted, scalped, and mutilated the dead. After ransacking and burning the camp, they left the site bearing human body parts as trophies and 600 horses, scattering the rest of the herd. Surviving Cheyenne and Arapaho people, many of them wounded, hid during the days, making their way north in frigid weather to encampments on the Smoky Hill River. Not one of our shining moments. The aftermath of the massacre, it says, the effects of the attack reverberated for years, profoundly unsettling the Cheyenne and Arapaho people. Several bands and their cultural traditions were essentially destroyed. So imagine, these are peaceful chiefs trying to bring peace between the settlers and their people, and almost all of them were wiped out. Losses left many families without providers and children without parents. 13 Cheyenne chiefs and one Arapaho chief were killed, along with many chances for peace, damaged. damaging the traditional governing council for generations. The treachery of the attack damaged the credibility of remaining peace chiefs like Black Kettle, gaining recruits to the warrior societies. So here he is trying to get all of his people to calm down and be peaceful. And where's the incentive to do that, right? Look what happens when we're peaceful. We go where they say that they want us to go. We can't peacefully. The massacre is ended. Across the plain, Cheyenne warriors declared all-out war. Some Denver citizens cheered the returning soldiers, who displayed their human trophies on the stage. But some were appalled at the killing and mutilations. The Congressional Joint Committee on the Conduct of the War took testimony, finding that Shivington had, quote, surprised and murdered in cold blood unsuspecting men, women, and children who had every reason to believe that they were under U.S. protection. Despite this condemnation, no one connected with the massacre was ever indicted or tried in military or civilian court. And Colonel Shivington was never excommunicated, not to do that, but he was never kicked out of the church, he was never reprimanded by the church. The Methodist Church didn't take any action after that. The events at Sand Creek, while setting off a new round of conflict, eventually helped to fuel a reappraisal of the treatment of Native Americans. So one good thing comes out of it. The glaring contradiction between America's ideals and events like Sand Creek, Ouachita, and Wounded Knee would increasingly trouble citizens. Emphasis gradually shifted from military, economic, and cultural subjugation of Native peoples to their assimilation into American society in the 1900s. The goal was to turn them into settled farmers and end loyalties to tribe and chief, quote, kill the Indian, save the man. This attempt to end the Plains Indians' way of life will only partly succeed due to the resilience of the Cheyenne and Arapaho people. So we kill them, we try to assimilate them, we try to make them, like us, farmers in a land that I can tell you I've been there is not a very farmable land. You think Eastern Wyoming between here and Pine Bluffs is hard to farm. Try going out in Eastern Colorado, especially during the drought they're having right now. Next slide, please. The benefit is that one good thing that's going on at the site is that they're gradually returning some of those remains. As horrific as that story is of them scalping the Native people, taking human body parts as trophies and burying them, a lot of those trophies ended up in historic sites. They ended up in museums. They're being found and they're being returned to the Cheyenne and Arapaho people who are going out to Sand Creek and reburying them at a site. If you go to the next slide, the site is heavily fence on one side. It's a corner fence. There's another one in the background, and then it forms a square. And so during that square, in that square, is where they're burying those remains and having healing ceremonies. That's the land that you don't walk on. You just get to the edge. So, next slide. This is along the edge of the ridge, and if you look down, those trees didn't exist at the time that the creek runs through where the trees are. Because, of course, out there in the plains where there's trees, there's a little bit of water, and that's where the creek was. So, you can imagine they're down in. They said that Colonel Shivington's troops couldn't even see the tops of the teepees, probably grown up on it. They knew where they were, but they were down in this valley. So, talk about being at a disadvantage. Hear this galloping herd, you think it's the buffalo coming towards you, and then you discover that no, it's a bunch of soldiers coming your way. Again, we had prayer cards that we were asked to read, and then we were able to share. It was a good opportunity to stop and reflect and again, make this a pilgrimage, not a tourist. Next slide. I want to read this one to you. This is one of the prayer cards, but it hit me why 150 years later this is still so fresh for so many of the Native people. It says, because of the tragic, destructive, and genocidal history of Native Americans in the U.S., a unique ailment affecting mind, body, and spirit has been identified as impacting many Native Americans today. It's called historical trauma, and it is derived from massive suffering visited upon people across lifespans and generations. Over time, the suffering and wounding accumulates within the people, both individually and collectively, and their unresolved grief becomes overwhelming. This is a drawing that was done on elk skin, and that's the poster over here is just a replica or a picture of it as well. It was done by a survivor of the Sand Creek Massacre, and the poster at the bottom says it's an elk hide painting by Eagle Grove, whose name is Eugene J. Grizzly Sr. He's a descendant of Little Raven, great grandson of Layman, who was a survivor of Sand Creek. It was painted in Memphis. task of citing him. The first two sets of buses went to the site first, and then came back to Eads, Colorado, where the National Park Service director of the historic site is on the left, and Bishop Lynn on the right, talked to us about the history and how the site finally got into the National Park Service hands and what they're doing to preserve it. The research is ongoing, and so a lot of the stories about why she came to the Vivian, some of his background is still being researched in the archives, but they haven't stopped that research. It's continuing. Next slide. That was Andy Paul sleeping on the way back, so you have to give her a bad time about that. It was a long day, for sure. This is at the dinner at the end of the day, so after we had about a 2-hour break after all the buses got back, and then we all got together in the convention center main auditorium, and we had a community dinner, they call it. And we got to hear from the descendants of Sand Creek about what it meant to go out on that pilgrimage. It meant a lot to me because as a United Methodist for 20 plus years, I didn't know this history, and I didn't realize that Shivington was Methodist, and that this is something that we all as United Methodists ought to know. We don't need to apologize for it. That was one thing that was emphasized. We didn't bear any responsibility. We weren't there. We didn't do it. So we don't have to apologize, but it really went a long way for them to go out there with us and to see the 600 people rowing the 413 buses and spend the day learning this history and spending time with them. So at the dinner, that's Bishop Lane on the left side. She's presenting. They presented these really nice blankets to all of them. But again, they all got to sleep and talk about how important it was. Next slide. So next time you look at the Sand Creek Massacre Trail site, I'd ask you to pause and think about the fact that there is some history. We are connected to it, for better or for worse, for better in the sense that we understand the history, we understand, and hopefully we'll treat Native American people better. We have a history in this church through Pam and others, Pam and Jeff and others, of reaching out to the Native American people, but there's a lot more that we can do. So next slide. So what do we do? The invitation at the dinner was that we continue to learn more about our history. I have a book about the Sand Creek Massacre that if anybody wants to borrow, you're welcome to. Again, look at the poster. Go online. There's a bunch of resources on the conference website. All you have to do is go to rmcumc.org and look on the right side, pull down the menu for annual conference. And all of the Bishop wrote a blog for months leading up to the pilgrimage, leading up to the annual conference. There's a lot of historical archived information. And I can send you all those links if you're interested in learning more. We also were invited at the dinner to be a sponsor for the Sand Creek Spiritual Healing Run and Walk, and I have that sponsorship form. Every year, right around the November time period, young Native Americans, many of them descendants of Sand Creek, go to Sand Creek to the site, and they do a healing run from Sand Creek to downtown Denver. And they take turns running. They don't all run the entire distance, because you're thinking, that's a long way, right? They don't all run the entire distance, but they take turns, they run in shifts. And when they arrive in downtown Denver, they go to the site where Silas Soule, remember the soldier who resisted and didn't participate in the battle, where he was assassinated. He testified in front of Congress, did all he could to share the story and try to let people know that this was a massacre, this was a horrible action. And for his troubles, a couple years later, he was assassinated in downtown Denver. That I remember the exact street, 5th or some street in Arapahoe, and Cross Street, and they're working on erecting a monument in his honor in downtown Denver. So they go there, they have a prayer, a little bit of a service, and they go to the state capitol. They pray and share some stories and testimony on the state capitol steps. And of course, this being the 150th anniversary of the massacre, there's a commission that the state of Colorado put together. Bishop Lane serves on the planning commission for that, putting together the plans for what they're going to do. We're invited to help sponsor some of those Native runners. It costs $500 per runner for them to participate in that with all the support that goes on. And so if you feel inclined, you might be doing something to the youth group to raise money to at least sponsor one runner from our church. So if you want to get involved in that, let me know. So to wrap up, I'd like to go back and read you another passage from that online devotional about healing running relationships. It spoke deeply to me, and I hope it resonated with all of us. It says, restoring damaged relationships is not easy. It takes humility and it takes effort. Sometimes an effort that will seem unbearable, depending on the nature of the rift. In the very worst cases, this process will take a long, long time. 150 years, maybe longer. And other factors will need to be considered. But the alternatives, Lasting bitterness, anger, insults, gossip, and the like are far worse, bringing their own damaging ripple effects, even poisoning our whole lives. Will you pray for me? Heavenly Father, we come to you today acknowledging what you already know, that we're deeply flawed people, but mostly with good intentions. We need your guidance and your healing touch, Lord, as we go through this human experience called life with other people. When we inevitably say or do something that offends someone else, let us be the first to recognize our mistake and take the first step to heal that broken relationship. And when we're hurt by someone else, let us do the often harder thing and still be the first one to reach out and initiate reconciliation. Lord, I ask that you continue to pour out your blessings of healing upon those of us in the United Methodist Church and our brothers and sisters in the Cheyenne and Arapaho tribes as we find new ways to heal a relationship that was so deeply damaged those long years ago. May you touch each of our hearts and show us the ways we can be in ministry with the native people of this land, bringing them healing and peace and working alongside them for social justice as we move forward together. I ask all of this in the name of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to stand and join in our words of prayer. Sand Creek